Good evening. I'm Scarlett O'Hurtia here with Wilhelm Scream, and you're watching the 2017 International WFTDA Division I Playoffs live from Dallas, Texas, brought to you by the Women's Flat Track Derby Association and Dallas Derby Devils.
Today we're going to see Queen City Roller Girls taking on Houston. It's going to be a great contest. Queen City, they're coming to you from Buffalo, New York. They are the 18th ranked 6th seed in this tournament. Houston Roller Girls, or Houston Roller Derby, the Houston All-Stars, obviously from Houston, Texas. They're the number 36 ranked team. They are the 11th seed in this tournament.
This is the first time Houston has actually been in the D1 tournament since 2014. So there's a lot they want to prove. And let's go ahead and run down some rosters. I will start with Houston. We have number 000, Black Lung Betty. Number 17, Acupuncture. Number 19, Betty Watch It. 215, Pay Yo Dues. Number 3, Speedo. Number 31, 2 by Force. Number 43, Diamond Cutter. Number 51 is Bustin' Beaver. Number 69, Death by Chocolate, a.k.a. DBC. Number 7, Kelly Kilpowski. Number 751, Hot Assets. Number 89, Arrakis. Number 900, Engine. And number 91, Slayer Moon.
Over on the Queen City side, the Lake Effect Furies. You've got number 1027, that's Bricks Hit House. Number 198, Black Rock Bruiser. Number 231 is Crazy Squirrel. 26 is Murphy. Number 303, Konichi Wow. Number 424 is Go. Number 46, Midnight Maniac. Number 505, Chickadee Mollish. Number 52, Tabrina Schreier. Number 54, Head Huntress. 60 is Pepper Sticks. 622 is Librarian. 666 is Incinerator. And 82 is Tuesday Hula.
Now out first for our first jam of the game, you have Houston's top point scorer, who so far in sanctioned play this year has 435 points, which nobody else on Houston's team comes anywhere close to her. She is matched up against number 622 from Queen City, Librarian, who is coming into this game with 352 points, so two very high-scoring jammers.
Librarian very quickly picking up lead jam, going on that outside line, gets lead for Queen City. Queen City in the black with the white and teal accents. Houston in the white with black and pink accents. Librarian is back in scoring position. Slayer Moon also out of the pack, looking to try and put some points on the board for Houston. Librarian going to quickly call off the jam before Slayer Moon can get any points. Looks like it is a 3-0 jam. Queen City drawing first blood from the score 3-0, 29 minutes and 20 seconds in the first half.
Let's check out this instant replay. We can see Hot Assets there trying to stop Librarian, but she manages to sneak by right past that hip of 2x4 and dodges a hit ever so slightly from Kelly Kilpowski. Now, who's out on the line now, Wilhelm?
That is Crazy Squirrel, number 231 for Queen City. Jam against Engine for Houston, number 900.
We got a triangle defensive formation from both teams on the track. And Queen City up in front and Houston in the back. Looks like we have a 4-3 pack advantage for Houston.
Yeah, it looks like Konichi Wow from Queen City spending some time in the 888 penalty box. Both jammers pushing near, trying to get through. We've just seen the Queen City jammer, Crazy Squirrel, just now past the pivot line in that first turn. Engine now pushing up towards the second turn, and the far straightaway does complete the initial pass, so lead jam going to Houston in jam number two, but Crazy Squirrel is right behind.
And very quickly after making that first scoring pass, both jammers hit that pack. Again, we have, two triangles two tripods that are formed on the track. Houston now down one blocker as well. So both jammers having to go it alone and go through a similar gauntlet. DBC breaking out just a little bit there, trying to play a one-woman defense. And looks like Betty Watchett trying to pull her pack up to the front. Beautiful spin move on the inside by Crazy Squirrel before Engine calls it off.
A little bit of a different style in the different jammers, too. Engine, more of a just hard nose, trying to push through. Crazy Squirrel is trying to do a lot of agility in that particular jam. Did end up with a 4-4 jam at the end of the result. So the score is now 7-4. Queen City on top, 27.5 to go in the first half.
And these have been some really short jams that we're seeing. I think jam number one was all of 20 seconds, and jam number two not taking up too much more time, and we're now going into jam number three, with Arrakis jamming for Houston and Librarian jamming once again for Queen City.
And Librarian playing a little bit of a waiting game, waiting, giving that opportunity for her blocker to come through, create the opening, play a little offense. Librarian now picking up lead jam for Queen City. Lake Effect Furies are going to try and put a little bit more pressure on Houston early on in this game. Arrakis looking to find an opening as well. But Librarian already threw. That's a five-point scoring pass. Natural grand slam with all five opposing skaters on the track. Arrakis now out coming around. Both jammers entering the apex between turns one and two. And Librarian calling off the jam while being thrown to the ground. Jam comes to a conclusion. We've got a 12-4 score with 26 and a half to go.
And it's worth noting here in that last jam, Arrakis was trying to pass that star to the pivot, but Queen City's blockers were just so consolidated there, she couldn't find any daylight and get that star over to the pivot at the time. However, she finds some daylight on the outside and on the inside and manages to get through. So Queen City taking 6 points on that last jam, Houston with zero.
We've got Go jamming for Queen City up against Slayer Moon. Slayer Moon very easily identifiable by that vibrant hair underneath the helmet. That's number 91 for Houston. Both jammers again fighting and tussling with stiff defenses being presented by both teams.
We got that triangle defensive formation once again, and Houston lost it for a minute there, regrouped, and then now Payo Dew's last line of defense trying to swallow up Go in the front. And looks like Slayer Moon is also out of the pack, eligible to score points.
Go ahead, sprung free, picked up lead jammer designation, but then tripped up. It allowed Payo Deuce to step back into place, but now both jammers out skating free and putting on a little bit of speed. Go, good edging on that outside line, calling off the jam, does put, looks like 2 points are being added to the board on the Queen City side. They now have a 15-4 lead, 25 minutes and 15 seconds remaining in the first half.
That was a beautiful eagle all the way down the straightaway there by Go. And we want to take an opportunity to thank 888, our penalty box sponsor. 888 makes helmets, pads, wrist guards, and they've got you covered. 888.com is where you can find more information.
Crazy Squirrel back out to jam for the Lake Effect Furies. Jamming up against Engen. Crazy Squirrel, you may remember previously skating with Kitchener-Waterloo. And Engen is out first. Engen picking up lead jammer for Houston this time around. Chance to chip into that Queen City lead. And so far, Crazy Squirrel unable to complete the initial pass. But now we're seeing the Queen City defense stepping in again. Just a strong, fierce defense. Midnight Maniac and Peppersticks. Two of those three that were in the back doing a great job to slow down Engen. Now Engen fighting through, gets around at the front, does create a little bit of an opening on the inside. The Crazy Squirrel exploits to complete the initial pass. Engen's already put 4 points on the board, however, and is looking for a little bit more.
Engen is 2-for-2 now on lead jammer status, and those spin moves that you're seeing there have been critical in her making her way through that pack, and it looks like during that last jam, Queen City had to adjust their strategy a little bit. They have been going purely defensive and holding back the other jammer, but when everybody was caught up in that little cluster, they had to jump up and provide some offensive assistance. But Engen manages to take advantage of the confusion and comes out on top, putting 8 points on the board for Houston. Score is currently 15-13. We have a 2-point game, Wilhelm.
And we've got Incinerator and Diamond Cutter jamming against each other this particular go-around. Lots of pushing. They're still just barely at the pivot line. Incinerator, number 666, into the 888 penalty box on a track cut. This is a power jam for Diamond Cutter and the Houston All-Stars opportunity. Thy name is Diamond Cutter. This power jam is going to help Houston. They whittled it down to only a 2-point difference right now. Lake Effect Furies, they're going to try and kill this penalty off. Good swinging defense. They're getting their blockers in the way very well. Murphy was bouncing there. And now Bricks Hit House, that last line of defense, dropping Diamond Cutter to the outside. Now you see number 7, Kelly Klapowski, coming along for Houston, trying to create a little bit more of an opening. Incinerator is still, or it has been returned to the track. Diamond Cutter already putting 5 points on the board, which means we've seen our first lead change of the game. We'll see if Houston can keep it going through the rest of this jam to maintain it at the end.
And we have a star stash there in order to get through that pack. Incinerator taking off that helmet cover. Diamond Cutter makes it through for one more scoring pass, puts 4 more on the board for a total of 9 points. And they're going to shut out. And here we go with the instant replay. Diamond Cutter finding a little bit of daylight on the outside, but takes a hit right there from number 1027, Bricks Hit House, to pull her down. Kelly Kilpowski there with a powerful hit. Kelly is actually a former hockey player, and you see that a lot in her blocking style. Super aggressive and very forceful.
So those 9 points put Houston on top, 22-15. First lead change of the game. We've got just under 22 minutes to go, and Slayer Moon jamming for Houston. Librelian into the penalty box on a track cut, the 888 penalty box. Once again, the home for the Queen City Jammer. A couple of jams in a row where Houston's had a power jam situation. Slayer Moon, however, not having a lot of luck so far. Konichiwa really doing a great job slowing down and stifling Slayer Moon, and again stepping in the last line of defense and delaying just enough that allows Blackrock Bruiser to step into place. Also allows Headhuntress to get in front.
Peyo's used with a nice offensive assist there, trying to clear out a Queen City blocker. And it looks like Slayer Moon grabbing lead jammer status gets taken out to the infield by number 52, Tabrina Schreier. But and one thing I will say is that what we've seen here in this jam and in a couple of them is both teams losing their formation. So we're seeing a lot of that kind of clustered, blended pack work, and it doesn't seem to be nearly as effective as when they stay really solid in those shapes.
So that jam ends 0-0. We've got a 22-15 score still with 20 minutes, 35 seconds remaining in the first half. Good, strong defense. And you're seeing those last line of defenses come forward, step into place, and really, even though the other jammer's getting through and picking up lead, they're then still being recycled back without technically completing the full initial pass.
Yeah, it's almost like even if you give up your point, you have to come back. That recycle on and on and on and on. You don't just let them go because they passed you. Now jamming for Houston, that's Engine going up against Go for Queen City. Big amalgamation of a pack there as they hit turn one.
Three jams in a row now. Power jam for Houston, and Engine is out with lead. Lake Effect Furies are sending their jammers into the triple eight penalty box.
We got a box formation by Queen City, and it looks like number 1027, Bricks Hit House, again leading the charge there and playing a little bit of leapfrog there with Engine as she gets by for 5 points.
And Houston found a way to open up the outside line. That gave Engine a wide open lane to go through and pick up the first 5 points. Now back in scoring position, getting pushed towards the outfield. A forearm penalty is being called against someone. Not sure who's
Bricks Hit House, who has been on Engine like white on rice during this game. Very effective, though. She's had more jammer takeouts, I think, than any blocker I've seen in this jam.
Go has returned to the track. Engine completing a second scoring pass. Another 10 points. But now Queen City's jammer out and skating free as well. Engine coming back around, catching them through turn three and four. Finds the pack. Takes a couple of bumps. Calls off the jam with four more points. A huge 14-point jam. Huge at this point of the game because we haven't seen that many big jams. So it's now 36-15, Houston on top. We've got 18 minutes and 40 seconds remaining in this first half.
We would like to thank Rydell. Rydell Skates, the innovative leader in roller skates for over 70 years. You can make your skates your own with custom-colored, handcrafted color lab boots by Rydell Skates. Check out RydellSkates.com.
We've got Crazy Squirrel lined up against Arrakis.
Very different placement there for both of those jammers. It looked like Arrakis was kind of hanging out on the inside, seeing what Crazy Squirrel was going to do on that inside lane before she charged forward. Both teams keeping their formations pretty solid here. But it looks like Arrakis was managed to break through first.
Yeah, Arrakis broke through first, picked up lead. Crazy Squirrel was not far behind. Houston currently holding the back of the pack. Lake Effect Furies holding the front of the pack. Jam called off, a 0-0 jam. No points put on the board. That keeps the score 36-15. We've got 17 minutes, 45 seconds left in this first half.
Indeed we do. And, you know, if you guys want to talk to us, we would love for you to connect with us on Twitter. Use the at WFTDA live account for live tweets of the WFTDA playoffs and championships. And if you want to tweet about what you're seeing, use the hashtag WFTDA playoffs. And if you want to talk directly to us at WFTDA.tv, use the hashtag talk2WFTDA.
Librolian back out wearing the star for the Lake Effect Furies for Houston All-Stars. That is Diamond Cutter. And Librolian picking up lead jam in this particular go-round. Queen City staring at a little bit of a deficit right now. Nothing too major this early in the game, but they've got to start putting a couple of scoring passes together and minimize for Houston. Diamond Cutter coming around as well. That forces Librolian to call off the jam early. And appears to be a two-point jam for Queen City. That puts the score 17-36. Houston still doubling up with 16 minutes, 45 seconds to go in the first half.
Sorry, it's my turn now. The WFTDA would like to thank our hosts, the Dallas Derby Devils, S1 Helmets, Pro Design Pads, Garzig Design, Adams Skates, Left Turn Clothing, Rydell Skates, Roller Con, Roller Derby Elite, Gaff Gun, Bont, 5-on-5 Magazine, 5-Second Skate Gear, and Derby Central.
Incinerator jamming for Queen City and tiptoed along, found an opening on the inside. That inside seam gives lead jammer to Incinerator and Queen City. Slayer Moon up in turn number two, tussling at the front of the pack, finally getting around. He's forced to be let go of Pepper Sticks, and I believe that was Midnight Maniac was the other Queen City blocker that were up there, slowing down, stifling Slayer Moon's pass. Four more points picked up by Queen City. That puts them at 21 to Houston's 36, just under 16 minutes remaining in the first half.
You know, we're seeing a lot of really low-scoring, very defensive games so far here at this tournament, and this is definitely no exception at all. 15 points separating these two teams with 15 minutes left in the first half. It's still anybody's game, and these are two players that have seen each other at least once or twice here so far in the first half.
We've got Engine back up against Go. Engine, number 900 in white, trying to push towards the front of the pack, trying to help really bridge out the Queen City defenders so that they are forced to peel off blockers into that bridging situation. Now, Engine getting knocked to the infield, forced to recycle back, and that creates the opening, gives Go the opportunity to pick up lead for Queen City. Lake Effect Furies, they've got control of the clock, and they've picked up, I believe, 3 in a row lead jammers.
That was a beautiful jammer takeout there that held Engine back by Queen City's pivot Murphy. I just have to point that one out. And then we've got some spin moves galore happening by Queen City's jammer Go. And they seem to be pretty critical in her strategy to get past this pack.
Yeah, one footing it backwards to keep herself on the track and under good control. Did complete the 5-point scoring pass. Blackline betting now with the star for Houston. Does put the helm cover on top. So activates jammer powers. That gives Go an opportunity to look back. Go trying to get towards the front, trying to push and grab a few.
Go had her eyes locked on Black Lung Betty. She was being pushed out of bounds simultaneously by 2x Force and Death by Chocolate, which is no small feat, and just kept staring. So this is where we actually see Queen City's box formation fall apart. This is where, and then that's the hit that I was talking about with Murphy. Taking out Engine and really kind of ringing her bell. It took her a minute to get back up from that.
So the score is now 30-36. Houston still on top. We've got just under 14 minutes to go. Crazy Squirrel jamming against Arrakis.
And once again, a bit of a stutter step or a waiting a minute for Arrakis before she took off. Wanted to see what Crazy Squirrel was doing. And right now it looks like Queen City is trying a 3-wall, but Arrakis manages to break on through. And she is your lead jammer for Houston.
Arrakis breaking up that streak. Crazy Squirrel also out of the pack. The pack itself is going to put a little bit of movement on, trying to get a little bit of distance between them, forcing the jammers to work a little bit harder to catch up to them. Arrakis now getting a whip from her teammate. Jam called off. Looks like a 0-0 jam. It keeps the score at 30-36. 13 minutes, 10 seconds left in this first half. And these teams, they still look like they're kind of feeling each other out. They've never played before. In fact, Queen City has never played any of the other teams that are here this weekend before.
That's impressive. And Houston hasn't played some of the teams that are here, but is also very familiar with some of them, just being an original WFTDA member and going all the way back to Dust Devil 2006.
We've got Librolian now jamming for the Lake Effect Furies. The Houston All-Stars respond with Slayer Moon, and Librolian puts Queen City back in control. One jam where they didn't have lead, they pick it back up again. And this one, looking at a 6-point deficit, but Librolian trying to just push through. Slayer Moon is also out of the pack. Little star stash. Now Librolian
Kelly Kiopowski with that Kelly. Very aggressive blocker strategy. She does not let them go. She's relentless.
It did result in Kelly Kiopowski picking up a low block call, sending her into the 888 penalty box. Jam is called off with a two-point game now. Queen City 34, Houston 36. And Houston's going to be down one blocker on the track.
So now look at this replay. This is where you see that hit from Kelly Kiopowski, which, oh, yeah, she got her leg tripped up there on the outside once they were both airborne. And I got to point out that the two most aggressive blockers on both teams, Bricks Hithouse and Kelly Kiopowski, have both accrued some penalties. So need to be aggressive but clean.
Incinerator continues the trend that Queen City has been trying to go and has had relative luck over the last six jams. Picks up lead once again for Queen City. Engine for Houston.
Beautiful lateral movement there by Incinerator to get through that pack. Again, we're losing those formations. And Engine hitting that two wall of Queen City blockers, knocking everybody down.
Well, and one of those blockers that Engine was having difficulty with is number 303, Konichi Wow. Now, a star pass on the Houston side. That puts the star into the hands of Black Lung Betty. Incinerator jumping over the apex, getting a little bit of a hop to complete the scoring pass.
And it looks like, you know, that's the second time we've seen Black Lung Betty take a star pass in, I think, four jams. So she's a target, and they're going to start noticing that. And I think Queen City has it out for Slayer Moon. They know she's one of Houston's most solid jammers typically, and they're combating that. Now look at this juke and this apex jump we see right here. Good combination of footwork and lateral movement on that track to get her through on that last scoring pass.
That 10 points puts Queen City on top. Lead change 44-36. Crazy Squirrel going to try and keep things going. Diamond Cutter going to try and change Houston's fortunes. Diamond Cutter picks up lead jam this time around. Crazy Squirrel now juking around and dodging acupuncture, then runs into Death by Chocolate.
Queen City reforming that box. Houston is not reforming their defensive formations nearly as quickly as Queen City, and I think it's starting to impact them. So they're doing a lot more one-on-one defense, and that's not where their strong suit lies.
Right now we got a score 44 for Queen City, 40 for Houston, under 10 minutes remaining in the first half.
Diamond Cutter 2-for-3 on lead jammer status. As we head into our next jam, we've got Go jamming for Queen City and Slayer Moon jamming for Houston.
Now, once again, this is a team that came in seeded sixth against a team that seeded 11th. Right now, the sixth seed is on top. And on the line for everything, the winner of this game is going to be coming back tomorrow to play arch rival, looking to punch their ticket to championships in Philadelphia.
And look at this squish that's happening here. Queen City's jammer Go trying to get past Betty Watchett and 2x4s, but they had her sandwiched for a good 15 seconds, I'd say. Peyo Deuce heading to the penalty box, and Slayer Moon has grabbed lead jammer status.
Slayer Moon grabbing lead jammer, calling off the jam, getting pushed towards the outside, saw that her opponent was about to come around, wanted to make sure not give any points up.
Slayer Moon clawing her way through that triangle. There we go with that lateral movement. Slayer Moon has a dance background, and you can see it in how she skates. She's super flexible, has great balance. Center of gravity is low because she's quite tiny. And you can see that how she's able to dodge a lot of those blocks. May hit the ground and Matrix move back, but she's up very quickly.
Got Librelian jamming against NGen in a now two-point game, 44-42. 8.5 to go in the first half. Librelian now pushing towards the front. Gets through, picks up lead jammer for Queen City. Engine also out for Houston. The pack currently in the apex between turns 1 and 2, kind of stationary. And Tuesday Hula sealing off the entire outside line. Looked like two lanes that Tuesday Hula had pushed the entire pack in. Gave a wide open space for her jammer. Librelian was able to pick up 4 points, call off the jam with a 48-42 score right now, just under 8 left in the first half.
So one thing that we've seen a little bit more of is Queen City adapting their defensive strategy around Houston's. Houston regrouped really quickly on that last jam to create that triangle formation, but Queen City just swallowed them up, and that's how they were able to move them two lanes over to clear space for their jammer.
We've got Incinerator now jamming against Arrakis, and Incinerator's going to push through, getting around Death by Chocolate at the very front of the pack. Arrakis now, with a little bit of a star stash, tangling with a couple of the Queen City blockers, gets through as well, but not before Incinerator back in scoring position and gets tripped up, calls off the jam, looks for a call against Death by Chocolate. The officials, they're conferring, but they do seem to disagree.
I would love to see a replay on that just because of the question mark on her face there. We've got 52-42, 7 minutes left in the first half. Queen City on top, but not by much. Okay, so here's the replay here. So we've got that was – I think that was incidental. I don't think that was intentional, but we'll see. And back to the action on the track. Who's jamming?
Crazy Squirrel jamming against Diamond Cutter. Crazy Squirrel hopping around on the outside does pick up lead. Little extra engagement happening from the Houston blockers, but had to let them go.
That was Betty Watchett up there, last line of defense.
And now Crazy Squirrel coming in, colliding a little bit of extra contact with Speedo.
And we've got whistles being blown, trying to figure out who's doing what. Looks like Bustin Beaver heading to the 888 penalty box. As we stay 55-42, Queen City coming out with 3 points on that last jam. And this is a great opportunity for us to thank our sponsors, including Adam Skates, Savant Wheels by Adam, light, fast, responsive, everything you look for in a wheel. Check out adamskates.com.
Got just under 6 minutes remaining in this first half, 55-42, Queen City starting to extend the lead a little bit, but this has been right around the largest lead of the game for either team. Neither team's really been able to put too much of a lead on. We've got Librarian jamming against Slayer Moon. Librarian picking up lead for Queen City. Slayer Moon tussling and tangling inside the pack, bouncing off of every single Queen City skater. Does get a little bit tangled up, but that dance background helps her regain her agility very quickly.
She skated that whole straightaway pretty much on one foot, like basically touching the ground, which was kind of impressive. And the jam gets called off before Slayer can put any points on the board. Queen City going to take three once again. We've seen several three-point jams going through. It seems like that's when the Houston jammer gets a little too close for comfort for the Queen City jammers, and they'd rather be safe than sorry, call it off, and shut out the team in white.
And vice versa. We're not seeing too many even attempts at multiple scoring passes unless it comes up in a power jam situation. Now we've got Go jamming against Engine, and Go trying to dance the inside line, but
Death by Chocolate with that jammer takeout there on the infield.
That was a great job and good awareness by Go to realize Skate had come out, have to recycle back behind.
Now this swarm that Houston just did, really nice job of creating a very tight, small three wall that was then formed into a triangle and just captured Go in the center, giving just enough room and time for Engine to break through on that line and grab lead jammer status.
And Engine with lead, and once again you saw Death by Chocolate, that last line knocking Go towards the infield. And then the Houston defense, they spread out backwards. They pulled Go back in. Had to go a third of the way back around the track before she could re-enter the field of play legally.
It looks like Death by Chocolate is heading to the 888 penalty box after getting out of the engagement zone with Bustin Beaver there, holding Go back in the front. Engine making some more scoring passes as we are at 58-42 with 3 minutes and 43 seconds left in the first half. And we have a power jam. Engine all by her lonesome out on that track.
A low block call assessed against Go puts Go into the AAA penalty box. So Engen trying to use the power jam, trying to get as many points as possible, but an impressively stiff defense being presented by Queen City. Their penalty kill is very fluid. Their defense is moving and making sure they just stifle Engen.
And on the other side of that coin, we've Houston choosing to leave Engen by herself and not really providing offensive assistance until the very last minute, and then they recalled that offensive assistance once Queen City's jammer re-entered the pack. Looks like we got 5 points for Houston on that pass score. Is currently 58-47 with just under 3 minutes left in the first half.
About to enter jam number 23 of this first half. Both teams with their full complement of timeouts and their official reviews still available. We've got Incinerator jamming for Queen City, going up against Diamond Cutter for Houston.
very solid pack off that line. Both teams creating those tripod defensive formations with one floater as an assist, and it looks like Diamond Cutter got shoved out of bounds and forced to recycle all the way back to turn four behind that jam line.
And Incinerator gets through, just found the opening seam, that slight extra space in the corner, found a way on the inside, now trying to hop a little bit. Wheels did come down and back under control. That is going to be a five-point scoring pass that is added. Incinerator is lead, and Diamond Cutter just not having a lot of luck, has now appears to have passed the star off to Speedo. Speedo having the jammer helmet cover in hand.
We've got some tangling going on in the front of the pack. Kelly Kopowski, an acupuncture, the last two lines of defense for Houston as entering turn three there. And Speedo is now out of the pack with the star helmet cover in her hand. And Diamond Cutter heading to the penalty box, but no longer the jammer. So at least there's that.
But Incinerator's already put 10 points on the board, looking to add a couple more. Calls off the jam, making sure that Houston can't add any themselves. That puts the score 72-47. We've got a minute 15 left in this first half.
This is definitely an exciting game. And look at this instant replay. So this was the apex jump that we saw here a little while ago. We're going backwards even. And she straddled that line
with
her skate.
You can see just how close.
Literally
that
two wheels
came
on either side of the line. Really nice track awareness, though. She manages to pull it off legally.
Crazy squirrel against Slayer Moon. Slayer Moon outside and then inside. A huge hole for Slayer Moon. Slayer Moon is out picking up lead for Houston. Crazy Squirrel also coming around and coming around quickly.
Pack speeding up. Queen City trying to take control of that pack and speed things up, move it along, making it more difficult for Slayer Moon to put points on the board, but she does anyway. That's 3 points for Houston, and we have an official timeout on the track. This official timeout is brought to you by Roller Derby Elite. Roller Derby Elite experience skating at a warp speed. The skates for when you are ready to level up your game. Check them out at rollerderby-elite.com.
Looks like it's actually an official review for Houston.
So as we go to the official review, and looks like the mic didn't quite carry over to the broadcast side, but once we learn what that review is for, we will definitely let you know. But this is a good opportunity for us to tell you about the We Believe initiative that WFTDA is supporting with UN Women. So this is an international initiative that the WFTDA has partnered with the UN Women initiative, and you can find out how to get involved and snag yourself an exclusive Roller Derby Can Change the World t-shirt at wftda.com/donate. Support for the WFTDA's partnership with UN Women is through our charitable giving platform, We Believe, and trying to bring roller derby across the world. Looks like they are going to burn that official review as a timeout. And we are quickly getting back to the action on the track with a new set of jammers.
That guarantees the one more jam. Scores 72-50. Under 30 seconds remaining. Librolian jamming against Engen. And Librolian fighting through at the front. Picks up lead. Getting around 2x4. Engen pinned back with Konichiwa. Konichiwa steering Engen pretty much everywhere on the track. Librolian gets through. Does take a little bit of a hit. But just absorbs the contact. Absorbs the block, picks up 5 points, getting through Queen City, extending their lead. Engen is out of the pack as well now. Librolian back in position and finding it 2x4 right away.
I think we've seen way more star stashes on the Houston side than we have on the Queen City side. And just like that, we come to halftime, and we're going to see a replay here of that quick pass past 2x4. Good spin move, man. That agility that Librolian has. She's so nimble on her feet, and that seems to be making a huge difference for Queen City on their scoring.
Yeah, that pirouette. And we've got a score of 78-50 right now. 14 and a half minutes left in the halftime. We've got, looking at the penalties, Bricks Hit House is sitting on 4, 2x4 with 3. Nobody else in any real danger, and neither team really penalty heavy right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really surprising, or I shouldn't say surprising, but it is pleasant to see that given how aggressive the play has been. We've had a lot of mixed packs. We've had a lot of formations that are intermingling with one another. And I think the key in the second half here is going to be Houston has to adapt to those changing formations that Queen City seems to have. They really readily go from a box to a tripod to a four wall across the track, really taking up presence across that track, and that seems to have led to this 28-point lead.
Yeah, exactly. In Queen City, they started out a little slow. They were kind of having that feeling out process. Not uncommon when teams have never played against each other. They're starting to assert themselves and say, look, we are the higher seed. We're the higher ranked team. We want to maintain that. So we'll see what happens. We've got 13 and a half minutes left in the halftime. We'll be back to look at some stats and run some more analysis in just a little bit. Welcome back for the second half of this contest. We've got this game going on between Queen City and Houston, 78-50 right now is the score at halftime. Once again, I'm Wilhelm Scream.
I'm Scarlett O'Hurria.
We are here on WFTDA.tv. It is the Division I playoffs live from Dallas. This is the final play-in game of the day. Game number four of the day. Winner's going to be playing against arch rival tomorrow. What do we see in that first half?
So we're seeing lead jam. It's actually pretty evenly split. If you look at the scorers that we have going on here, Incinerator and Engine, both with 32 points for their respective teams. Librarian really making a difference there with 28. Diamond Cutter with 13 on Houston's side. Go with 11. Crazy Squirrel with 7. Slayer Moon with 5. And Arrakis with 0, surprisingly. So we're seeing a very different look to the four jammer rotation if you look at the two teams for sure. And in terms of lead jammer status, they're relatively even. Queen City took lead jammer status 56% of the time, Houston with 44% of the time. But one thing that was really big difference in the first half was those jammer penalties. Queen City with 3 jammer penalties, Houston with 0.
Yeah, you are seeing a 4 and a 1 on your screen right now. But that one penalty picked up by Diamond Cutter came after the star had been passed, so didn't serve as the jammer. Same thing with one of the Queen City blockers or jammers, where the star was passed, then a little bit of time in the 888 penalty box.
So this was a story of defense for sure. We saw Queen City was a little bit more flexible with their defense, and that really was key in them racking up some of those points. Houston didn't give up any power jams there in the first half, but had a few to capitalize on and didn't quite get there because Queen City's defense was just so tough. And we should mention that there was an official review at the very end there. Queen City trying to get a direction of gameplay penalty called on Hot Assets number 751, but the challenge was declined. So call stands, and we get back to the action here in the second half.
Okay, once again, we've got a score. Lake Effect Furies from Queen City, from Buffalo, New York, 78. Houston with 50. Queen City, the 6th seed in this tournament. Houston, 11 seed. Librarian jamming against Slayer Moon to open up the second half. Slayer Moon trying to lean and push. Librarian finds an opening on the inside, gets around, completing the initial pass. Running away from the Houston jammers or Houston blockers. Houston already utilizing a star pass that goes straight to number 3, Speedo. I'm going to try and minimize the damage. Librarian picks up 4 points on the board. An 82-50 score.
So Librarian really taking advantage there of Houston's defense not regrouping after they got Speedo through as she took over at jamming duties, so to speak. So Librarian finding a little bit of daylight, I mean a matter of inches in between, I believe, 2x4 and Kelly Kilpowski there at lane 2, and squeaks on by for 4 points.
So 82-50, 29 minutes left in this contest. Crazy Squirrel jamming against Engen. Crazy Squirrel trying to push near the front and finds Death by Chocolate. Engine being pushed out of the back. Force Recycling comes in and runs right into Midnight Maniac. Crazy Squirrel picks up lead. It's only the second time in this game that Crazy Squirrel's been able to do that.
But I got to say, one thing we're seeing with Crazy Squirrel, this is a different technique than I think we saw from her in the first path, where she was taking really big, really aggressive, firm steps, moving that entire defensive pack forward so she could make some headway. She broke up Houston's defensive formation and strung them out one by one, and that really seems to be working for her.
And Crazy Squirrel keeping an eye on the clock, looking at her bench, and it keeping a good eye on engine, lets as much time lapse as possible, then calls off the jam. Queen City puts 4 up to Houston 0, 86-50, 28 minutes, 15 seconds left in this game.
Now, Diamond Cutter is one that we saw make a pretty big difference in the first half for her team. This is her first WFTDA playoff tournament, and she is making a name for herself going up against Librolian here in jam number 3.
And Librolian was staring down Diamond Cutter. Right now, a 4-2 pack advantage in favor of the Houston All-Stars.
But one of those two blockers on the track still for Queen City is Brix Hithouse, and she is making her presence known. She has been the anchor of Queen City's defense today, and we see that right here as she held Diamond Cutter back. Diamond Cutter did grab lead jammer status. However, she got swallowed back up into the pack and was forced to recycle all the way back past that jam line.
And Librolian passing the star off to her pivot. That is Midnight Maniac, number 46. Once again, if you're just tuning in for the second half, Queen City in the black with white and teal accents. Houston, the white with black and pink accents. And now a penalty sends Diamond Cutter into the 888 penalty box. Midnight Maniac on a power jam for Queen City. This is the first power jam Queen City has had in this contest.
And we've got the star being handed over, as we mentioned before, Midnight Maniac taking over those jammer duties, and now she's got an opportunity here to really spread out those points, but she's got to contend with Peyo Dews and Kelly Kilpowski in the front. Again, Houston breaking apart, and that seems to be how Queen City is dismantling them and racking up points little by little.
Well, and that tandem of Peyo Dews and Kelly Kilpowski, it was a moment where actually them breaking apart might have helped things out a little bit because they stuck together, which pulled Kelly off of the inside line, gave the opportunity for Midnight Maniac to pick up the points. Diamond Cutter has returned to the field of play and is out and skating free. Initial pass completed. Full 2-minute jam is underway. There's only 15 seconds remaining in this jam. Midnight Maniac trying to push at the front and finds Kelly Kilpowski, then steps back. A little defensive posture shown by Midnight Maniac trying to slow down Diamond Cutter. The pivot reasserting themselves as a reminder that pivots largely do spend a lot of time playing defense. Didn't slow down Diamond Cutter too much. Did allow for 4 points on the Queen City side. Diamond Cutter grabbed stolen 2 points.
But it looks like Diamond Cutter is actually heading to the penalty box for a forearm penalty. And it looks like we've had the high, I've noticed that. Okay, here's the replay there. Boom, hard hit there by Hot Assets, but Midnight Maniac managing to get through no problem. And now we've got Diamond Cutter starting in the 888 penalty box.
That makes this a power start and now a power jam for Go. Go is through, picks up lead very quickly.
You know, one thing we were noticing in the first half, it's carrying over into the second half, is these are really low-scoring individual jams. We've only had 2 jams that were really kind of runaway point scores very quickly, and we've had 2 of them, one for each team, 14 points apiece.
At Queen City now, this is an opportunity for them to put together multiple scoring passes in one jam. Diamond Cutter has returned to the track, but Go has already put 10 points on the board. And looking for a few more. Diamond Cutter still pinned back, unable to complete the initial pass. The Queen City defense, that's just a swarming defense, just sealing everything off. Now Houston's defense doing a good job to stifle Go. Here comes Konichiwa trying to play offense, stepping in and looking to open up that hole.
Taking out blockers in the process. Not even a jammer takeout, a blocker takeout there by Kenichi Wow. And if you look at the difference between these defensive formations, we've got Queen City really committing to that triangle, whereas Houston is kind of switching between that tripod and the box formation, and they're not really shifting and keeping it as tight as Queen City is. Queen City's, once they get into that tripod, they don't move.
Well, and one thing that we're able to notice looking at those defensive postures is that Queen City, because of what they've been able to do defensively, that they've had that strong defense, it allows them to spring and play offense very quickly. Konichiwa has been doing a lot of offensive blocking, trying to create the opening. Queen City now calling off the jam, another 3 points. That makes it a 17-point jam for Queen City, and Houston held off the board.
That is the highest scoring jam thus far. If you look at that eagle right in the apex with a spin move off of Speedo. Looks like we have a team timeout called by Houston, and that's a great opportunity for us to tell you about 888 helmets, pads, wrist guards. They've got you covered protecting Derby since day one. And, you know, 888's got these really cool new helmets that protect against rotational violence with MIPS patented brain protection systems. And that is, you can find those at 888.com. Also, don't forget about the 2017 WFTDA Playoffs Bracket Challenge. Have you made your predictions for this weekend's games? Compete against your friends for great prizes from WFTDA.tv, S1 Helmets, and Radar Wheels. Visit WFTDA.tv and get your predictions in for Dallas now.
This Roller Derby Elite timeout almost over. Queen City, the first 20 minutes of the game felt like a feeling out period. The last 10 minutes of the first half, Queen City put up more points than they had in the previous 20, and they've just been continuing that. Momentum is entirely on their side right now. Score is 107-52. Houston, they're going to try and get some back. That was what that timeout was all about, is trying to reset, re-strategize, and see if you can find the opening. But Incinerator now out and jamming first for Queen City. Slayer Moon for Houston, and a lot of back bridging that was being done by Queen City. Not enough, however, because they did peel off a blocker into the penalty box, and now Slayer Moon is out and picking up lead jammer status for Houston.
So something we saw right here was the entire pack got really spread out, making it nice and easy for Slayer Moon to find some daylight. She did take a couple of hard hits, but again, that flexibility and that adaptability, she manages to zigzag her way through, and here on her first scoring pass, found some space on the outside and was largely unopposed. And just there, she stayed in bounds on one foot, but was leaning really far horizontally and took a hit from a blocker and called it off while in the air. So Slayer Moon taking 8 points, and I think this is where we see that sneak around to the outside, grabbing lead jammer status right after the whole pack got really strung out, and that was one of the rare times we've seen Queen City's blockers get spread apart and take on that one-on-one defense.
So the Bruins score 107-60, 22 minutes, 10 seconds left in this second half. Crazy Squirrel jamming against Engine. They're both trying to go through the same non-opening in the pack. Both found the outside line, but it was sealed off very impressively. The defense is working in tandem that time. Now Crazy Squirrel bounced towards the infield. Engen leaning on the Queen City pack. They have not yet reached the pivot line, and we're already 20 seconds into the jam. Now Engen now still trying to put as much of a lean on. We've got a 4-on-3 pack situation, and now Engen pushed towards the outfield and will be forced to recycle back. Crazy Squirrel dancing and juking, going outside, inside, lateral movement, but again, stifled. They eventually have to let Crazy Squirrel go, and lead jammer going to Queen City.
It took them 50 seconds to get that lead jammer status, so definitely a well-fought, hard effort by Houston. It looked like the last two lines of defense were Betty Watchett and Kelly Kilpowski. And now, again, we've got that blending of the packs here, which made it really a little bit easier for Crazy Squirrel to get through with a couple of spin moves. She grabs 5 points before calling it off. Our score is currently 112-60. Here's we head into jam number 7 with under 21 minutes left in the game. Crazy Squirrel is 1-for-6 on lead jammer status and 2-for-2 in the second half. So I don't know what Wheaties she ate at halftime, but it seems to be working.
It's going to set us up with a go taking the star for Queen City in a power start situation. Engine being assessed a track cut, so spending some time in the 888 penalty box. Carried over between the two jams.
And look, one thing that we're seeing a little bit more here in the second half is Queen City providing some offensive assistance. And we previously saw them keeping that really solid triangle, and that's all they would focus on. And their roamer would really just be a bridge or would create a box formation. But now we're seeing that roamer go in and actively break up Houston's defensive shapes.
And a number of previous jams, we were seeing K-Wow as the roamer that was playing that offense. This time it's Bricks Hithouse that's stepping in to switch from defense to offensive play. Go is already through, picks up 5 points. Now we're seeing number 26, Murphy, the pivot for Queen City, headed to the 888 penalty box. Engen has returned to the field of play. Initial pass now completed, But Go has already put 9 points on the board and going to call off the jam again, letting NGen get close to the pack, but then stifling it before Houston's able to put any on the board. A score of 121-60 for Queen City. They're doubling up on Houston with 19.5 left in the game.
We'd love for you to check out Bont.com. Get some really lovely, fantastic fitting performing skates at Bont.com.
Librolian wearing the star for Queen City. Arrakis for Houston.
Again, Arrakis with that delayed start, just watching to see where the other jammer goes. I would be curious to know what the purpose of that is. Maybe, you know, not following the other jammer, or maybe following the other jammer. And whatever it did this time, it worked for Arrakis. She manages to get through first and foremost, and she is now your lead jammer.
Well, one of the things that sometimes comes into play with that slight delay is you can see if the pack is pulled one way or the other by your opponent. But now Arrakis stretching out the Queen City wall.
Turned the tables completely. That was something we saw Queen City doing a lot to Houston's defense here a little while ago. But Arrakis with that solid hit, one after one after one, all about the follow-up and the follow-through.
Now Arrakis picked up 5 points in that first scoring pass. Does call off the jam because Queen City was coming around. An additional point, so 6 points, and here you're going to see Arrakis.
That hit check. Oh.
A clean hit, a strong hit, and bouncing off of some of the blocks being put out, especially that one from number 54, a Headhuntress, and number 26, Murphy. So this sets up 121-66, 17 minutes, 50 seconds left. We've got Crazy Squirrel jamming against Slayer Moon.
Slayer Moon forced way back to turn four, way behind the jam line after being taken out right at the jam line. It looks like that was just enough for Crazy Squirrel to find some daylight in the front and grab lead jammer status for Queen City.
Yeah, Houston was able to stifle Crazy Squirrel in the first half, not able to do so in the second half. And Crazy Squirrel does get through only 2 points, but jam called off, keeps Houston off the board in that jam, makes the score 123-66 and 17 minutes, 15 seconds remaining.
So we should note that the jam prior to that, jam number 8, were the first points that Arrakis has scored. She's been out on the track quite a bit, but Queen City effectively shutting her down for the most part. Seems like she just found the magic moves to get through on this last jam, and Queen City held to 2 points here in jam 9. We head into jam number 10 with NGen wearing the star for Houston and Incinerator for Queen City with a spin move out in front lead jammer.
And both of these jammers came into the second half knotted at 32. That's where they've remained up until this jam, as Incinerator is already out and lead. NGen now completing the initial pass, Incinerator in scoring position.
That's where we just saw that Queen City adaptability. They quickly shifted from that defensive formation after NGen got through and really swallowed up the whole Houston pack and held them to those inside two lanes so that she could find some space on the outside. And that's been really critical for Queen City thus far.
Queen City 127, Houston 66, 16 minutes remaining in this game. Arrakis back out for Houston, jamming against number 424, Go.
We're going to see if we can keep up that momentum. And Queen City has had lead jammer status in about 70% of the jams thus far. So let's see if Arrakis can break up that pattern. And it looks like Queen City wants to maintain that pattern.
Oh, and Murphy thought that they lured Arrakis into a cut. Murphy did not. But there is instead a penalty being assessed against Arrakis. There's a forearm call sending Arrakis into the triple eight penalty box. Go is now on a power jam for Queen City. Houston was able to avoid giving up any power jams in the first half. This is, I believe, their third or fourth already in the second half.
Third. It's their third. And we see the Houston trying to take control of that pack, moving it up forward in a little bit faster clip. One-on-one defense there. Betty Watchett, last line of defense. And effectively,
Betty Watchett's blocking ended the jam because Go decided to just call it off rather than try and recycle back.
The look on Go's face as she came off that track was hilarious. And look at this hit right here, Arrakis. That follow through. Yep, that follow through got her that forearm penalty that resulted in that power jam They gave a grand slam to Queen City, currently 132 to Houston 66, with just under 15 minutes left in the game. We're heading into jam number 12 with Crazy Squirrel all by her lonesome.
Crazy Squirrel is out with as the jammer. Arrakis starting out in that triple eight penalty box. Crazy Squirrel tried luring everyone towards the outside, but Houston sniffed out the problem and very quickly were able to bounce back in and seal off any of the lanes that Crazy Squirrel is trying to create. Now they're fighting and tussling at the front.
It looks like now this is different than what we've seen. We've seen Houston moving forward a lot with that defensive formation, but right now they're at a standstill. Crazy Squirrel calling for an offensive assist because she just can't move that triangle of 2x4s, Kelly Kilpowski and Bustin Beaver.
Yeah, Pepper Sticks stepping in, creating that opening, giving that offensive capability. Now Crazy Squirrel back in scoring position, but Arrakis is out as well. That back bridging, when Arrakis was recycled back, the back bridging has spread out the Queen City defense too much, allowed Arrakis to get through. The 133 to 66, a one-point jam. 13 minutes and 40 seconds remaining in the game.
Crazy Squirrel has had 100% lead jammer status here in the second half, grabbing 12 points so far in the second half for her team. And it looks like they're going to keep up with that strategy. And we have headed into jam number 13 with 13 minutes left in the game.
Librarian jamming for Queen City up against Houston's Slayer Moon. And Librarian being slowed down at the front, but is let loose and picks up lead. Now Slayer Moon knocked to the outside.
I don't know how to describe that fall.
Awkward, almost bridging position.
Almost a back bend.
And by bridging, I don't mean derby bridging. I mean back bridging. Librarian now already out through for 5 points, back in scoring position, and Slayer Moon
fights her way through on that inside, takes off the star for a stash, and manages to get through. So she is now on a scoring pass. But Queen City has had amazing pack awareness and jammer awareness here. Looks like Slayer, right as she approaches that pack, doesn't get a chance to score, but Queen City comes out of that jam with 9 points.
So scores 142 to 66, Queen City on top. The Lake Effect Furies looking comfortable at this point to be stamping their way to the game against arch rival. We've got 12 minutes and 15 seconds left in the game. Queen City is doubling up, and Engine going to be jamming for Houston. Queen City responding with go. Engine finds a wide open inside lane. She was coming at you as she grabbed lead.
Now we headed into this half at a relatively even score with just a small difference between the two. But here in the second half, Queen City has outdone Houston 64-16. And we are seeing that right here. Oh no, another jammer penalty. Looks like Engine heading to the box for a cutting the track penalty. And that is not what Houston needs right now. We're going to have a full 2 minute jam, but Engine taking her second penalty.
Yeah, Queen City's really cleaned up their penalties in this second half. They didn't have a lot in the first half. They've been able to minimize those even further in the second half. Go already with 5 points on the board, looking to add some more. Engine is standing in the triple eight penalty box, but has under 10 seconds remaining in that penalty time. Go looks like she's not going to try and freeze the opposing jammer.
Looks like Black Lung Betty being trapped in the back by that Queen City defense. And Engine back into the fray. Both jammers at a similar point on the track. It looks like Houston was able to hold Queen City and go to only one grand slam while Engine was in the penalty box. Looks like Engine grabbed 4 points on her first scoring pass. And we have two very split defined defensive formations right at turn three.
Engine did get around. And looked like there was a moment where Engine thought about trying to call off the jam. Luckily for Engine, that did not work because she's not lead. That is something that Go has the capability of, but it was the posture that Engine had as she was bounced towards that outside. Now we've got Go back in scoring position. Engine in scoring position as well. A 10-4 jam so far. 3 seconds remaining on this jam before it comes to its natural conclusion. Jam does expire. The 2 minutes totally gone. 13 points in the jam for Queen City, 6 for Houston. A score of 155 to 72. 9 minutes, 50 seconds remaining in the game.
Now, those were the first points that Houston has put on the board in the last five jams. So, Engine breaking that pattern and really trying to move things forward. And now we've got some familiar faces back out on the jam line.
It's going to be Arrakis jamming against Incinerator. And Arrakis, that little bit of delay. And this time, Incinerator also delaying, letting Arrakis try and pick the line first. Then Incinerator almost found the opening on the inside. Speedo, very good position and blocking Incinerator into the infield, forcing Incinerator to recycle back.
And it looks like Incinerator is going to head to that 888 penalty box for a forearm penalty. So we have a power jam on our hands with lead jammer status still on the line.
Arrakis is out and picks up lead. Actually, a situation where Midnight Maniac, by being taken off the track and into a down position, prevented her own blocker, her own teammate, from getting in front and stopping that Houston jammer. Arrakis now in scoring position in this power jam for the Houston All-Stars. Trying to draw a track cut against Arrakis is Murphy. Does not work. That allows Arrakis to get through. That's a five-point scoring pass.
So one thing we're seeing right here is a little bit of a switch, because Houston now trapping that Queen City blocker that was Brick's hit house. No small feat there in the back, so Arrakis could get through, and they had that pack definition. Nice assist by Kelly Kilpowski trying to clear some blockers out of the way. Arrakis with a grand slam on her first scoring pass, and now she's through for another one.
Incinerator out of the AAA penalty box is through. That's a scoring pass completed for Incinerator as well. Arrakis, the second scoring pass for each in that particular go-around. So 4-9 jams so far. Arrakis back in and trying to push and lean at the front.
Now, once again, we had that offensive assist there by Speedo trying to break up that solid. It was a box, but now it's transformed into a tripod because they needed that bridge player there. And everybody's pushing together. It's kind of like a rolling, I hate to say mosh pit, but that's the only analogy I can come up with right now.
Yeah, Bustin Beaver took a little bit of a hit, but was able to really stop the jammer from getting through. Makes the score 163-85, a 13-8 jam for Arrakis. We've got just over 7 minutes remaining in this game.
Rydell Skates. Shout out to Rydell Skates, proud sponsor of the 2017 WFTDA playoffs. When you need to roll quick, think quick. Quick Bearings, where precision meets performance.
That replay just showed a great block by Speedo pushing opposing jammer to the infield. We've got Librolian against Diamond Cutter now, and Librolian up near the front pushing against the Houston pack, but Diamond Cutter trying to pull everyone out. Librolian does get through, goes towards the outside and then the infield where the inside line was wide open. Librolian is leading. Diamond Cutter having a bit of difficulty.
She shrugged off one of the Houston blockers there. I believe that was Hot Assets. And juked past that block. And it looks like we have a forearm penalty being called on Queen City's pivot. Konichiwao.
K-Wow into the 888 penalty box. But there's still Midnight Maniac, Headhunters, and Pepper Sticks making things miserable for Diamond Cutter on this initial pass through the pack. Now, Death by Chocolate drawing back Librolian. Hot Assets taking the star for Houston. The star pass has been completed. Librolian going to try and complete the opening. It engages with Death by Chocolate a little bit as the jam is being called off. 5 points for Queen City, a 168-85 score.
And there, yeah, that's where she shrugged off Hot Assets, and then right after that, Diamond Cutter taking a hard hit to the infield. So we're seeing some very aggressive packs out here on the track. And guys, if you're still listening to the free audio coverage today, it's not too late to get that high quality video feed. It's just $16.99 for the weekend. So make sure that you get that high quality video. You're going to want to see that, especially tonight, our last game of the evening, where we have Dallas versus Texas. That's going to be a great thing that you need to watch and feel the crowd on. And we have a timeout on the track. As we mentioned before, this is Houston's second timeout, and it is brought to you by Roller Derby Elite. Roller Derby Elite, experience skating at warp speed. Roller Derby Elite is this are the skates you need when you are ready to level up your game. Check them out at rollerderby-elite.com.
Got 5 minutes, 48 seconds left in this game. 168 for Queen City, 85 for Houston. There's still a little bit of time. Queen City has been just sitting on all their clock stoppages. Houston now only the ability to stop the clock two more times. It's also at the point where they might have to start considering running the jams long. If they've got a matchup that they like, they might have to run it long because the game is a little out of hand, but ranking points are going to start coming into play as well. Crazy Squirrel jamming against Slayer Moon, and Slayer Moon is someone that could run this long if she's able to get through. Slayer Moon is out first, but a no pass, no penalty situation, so is not lead.
We've got Kelly Kapowski with a nice jammer takeout to the infield, and then Betty Watchett doing much the same to Crazy Squirrel on the outside, forcing her back to that jam line as Slayer Moon is now on her first scoring pass. And we've got a 4-3 pack advantage for Houston as one of the players from Queen City is currently in the 888 penalty box. And now Slayer Moon doing that chip away method where you have one blocker, one blocker, one blocker. She manages to get by with a spin move and racks up 5 points. But we get lead jammer status declared for Queen City, and it's called off as soon as that.
Crazy Squirrel showing that she can do a little bit of a pirouette of her own. Does call off the jam, but 5 points picked up by Slayer Moon before the end of the jam. 168 to 90 now. Under 5 minutes to go in this contest. Looks like NGen's going to be back out for Houston, jamming up against number 424 in black. That is Go.
Full complement of blockers on the track as NGen tries to jet to the inside. We've got a very fluid pack, lots of lateral movement there, but as a group, except now Queen City breaking apart their normally strong defensive formation and allowed NGen to get through. She is your lead jammer.
Yeah, NGen was tussling with K-Wow at the front. Konishiwa ended up letting go, and Midnight Maniac was coming in, and NGen just sidestepped Midnight Maniac's hit. Now back up at the front, tussling, trying to get through on that scoring pass. But NGen trying to, right now it looks like spreading out. K-Wow is the one stepping back into the bridging situation. Now also looking to play a little offense. Spring the jammer through. Death by Chocolate trying to chase down Go. Unable to do so. Go picks up 4 points. NGen looks like going to call off the jam from the outside of turn number three. Houston putting 4 points on the board as well. So that makes the score 172 to 94, an even up jam and under 3.5 to go.
Indeed, it is. S1 helmets. The S1 Lifer helmet is the best fit and superior protection, but we're going to look at this replay real quick. That is some beautiful toe stop work there, just barely leaping over DBC's foot there on the inside to stay in bounds. Very nice edging there.
Librolian against Arrakis and a huge hit. That was Kelly Kopowski knocking Librolian not just to the outfield, but a couple of feet into the outfield. Now Arrakis pushing at the front, and the Queen City defense doing what they've been doing so much throughout the day, which is making things tough on those Houston jammers. Librolian is out and lead.
Arrakis now out of the pack as well on her scoring pass, and there was really no defensive structure right there from either team, which really easily allowed Librolian to get through. She grabs her points and calls it off. And I want to tell you guys about S1 helmets like I tried 2 minutes ago. The S1 Lifer helmet is the best fit and superior protection made for roller derby. Get a lifer, be a lifer, a lifer. And don't forget about the S1 Lifer visor helmet. Next level protection for, especially if you're a jammer and you got to squeeze through that pack. Occasionally you catch elbows, especially if you're on the shorter side. So grab you a S1 Lifer visor helmet.
Slayer Moon against Crazy Squirrel. That last replay, you got to see that.
Beautiful jump.
You got to see that the jammer was not completely off of your camera's frame. Crazy Squirrel is lead, and a star pass, a star stash, it looks like, being done on the Houston side. Indeed, Slayer Moon had held on to the star the entire time.
I think it was dropped on the track, actually. I think we had a star drop. Looks like Queen. Oh, so here's the replay here. Look at this leap here, right over Betty Watchett as she comes in backwards for that hip check.
And you can definitely indeed see, too, that Slayer Moon had the star not in her hands, not on the helmet, so had to come back and pick it up. But only 2 points picked up by Queen City. 178-94, a minute and a half to go. Librarian and Engine, your jammers. Librarian spreading things out again.
Very spread out. We had those three Houston blockers up at the front, but even they had to spread out across the track and didn't really have that bridge player because they had one in the box. And it looks like we're sending Speedo to the box for that play. Oh, beautiful apex jump there. Very high knees by Librarian.
Engen trying to find the way around, getting through for the initial pass, but runs into Headhuntress. Now a spin pirouette again, but using all levels, not just the standing pirouette, but ducking down low. Librarian able to complete another scoring pass. That's a 10-point jam so far. Engen now out of the pack. Librarian looking at a 3-wall from Houston.
Now, Queen City has now scored points in 18 of the 21 jams we've had so far, but we've seen quite a few of these shutouts here, keeping Houston at zero for each of those. We now have a timeout on the track. That is going to be Houston's last regular timeout, and that's brought to you by Roller Derby Elite. Roller Derby Elite, experience skating at warp speed. Roller Derby Elite, the skates for when you are ready to level up your game. And look at this replay here.
There was that multi-level pirouette and then absorbing the hit by Bustin Beaver, slotting off of it to continue through.
Now, this is interesting. Houston just now opting to switch out their jammer before the jam starts. They had Diamond Cutter out on the track and switched over to, I believe that is, it's either Slayer Moon or Hot Assets. I can't see from here. But Diamond Cutter with 3 penalties so far. Slayer Moon with 0, completely clean. And the only 2 players that have 4 penalties are both some rather intense blockers. Bricks Hit House from Queen City and Pay Yo Dues from Houston.
So the score is 190-94, 25 seconds left on the clock. This is more likely than not the final jam of this game. We do have Slayer Moon jamming against number 424, Go.
And Slayer Moon only has to contend with 2 Queen City blockers. We have a 4-2 pack advantage for Houston. Houston doing a good job of staying together there right after that jam line and really trapping Go. So Slayer Moon out in front, lead jammer for Houston, and is now on her scoring pass.
Yeah, those two blockers that Slayer Moon had to contend with were Bricks Hit House and Pepper Sticks. Now we're seeing some of the Queen City blockers released from the 888 penalty box, slowing things down for Slayer Moon, but Houston doing a great job in this jam, stifling Go, not giving the opportunity. Slayer Moon is now out. Another scoring pass completed for Houston. More importantly, the period clock has expired, so there's only a minute and 13 seconds remaining maximum in this game. Houston's looking to try and get themselves over that 100-point mark. Looks like Slayer Moon will have done so. She's in that scoring pass now, has points in her pocket. Go being recycled back. Slayer Moon pushing at the front and runs into Pepper Sticks. Also up near the front is Murphy. And Sabrina Schreier is holding on as the third defender up at the front, drawing Slayer Moon way back.
Slayer trying to sneak by with a few inches there in lane 4, edging right along that outside line before she is met with some resistance. And she pushes Go to the infield.
Go has finally completed that initial pass, is on a scoring pass of their own. Slayer Moon trying to fight through. Go now is going to find the opening. She is going to grab a few more points. Go has points in her pocket as well. Both jammers on that scoring pass, they have passed a few people. We don't know what the total is going to be, but we do know Houston is going to cross that century mark.
Betty Watchett, last line of defense, but she gets that out of play penalty, and Go is let go as Betty Watchett heads to the 888 penalty box. And we have an unofficial final on the track.
Right now, the one unofficial final, 195-104. Queen City taking this down. They're going to be coming out, and here you're seeing.
Oh, Pay Yo Dues taking a hard hit, getting thrown backwards. And I think they were trying to hide Slayer Moon behind Pay Yo, but wasn't fooling anybody.
Bricks Hit House just delivered a physical hit. Looking at the penalties in this game, you've got 5 picked up by 2x4s, 5 penalties picked up by Bricks Hit House, but nobody is in any real danger beyond that, and the penalties relatively even on both sides.
Yeah, and I think the display is actually a little flippy floppy because Pay Yo Dues has actually racked up the 5 penalties. 2 by Force has only racked up 2. So we've got a little bit of a flip-flop going on here. But penalties, nobody fouling out, so that was not really the story. However, we did have some jammer penalties that were really killer for Houston in the second half.
Yeah, especially in that second half. I mean, the first half, Houston didn't give up any power jams. They kept their jammer skating clean. The second half, they found themselves going into the AAA penalty box repeatedly, and Queen City cleaned up their side of the equation. But even when you look at that first half, I mean, Houston had the 3 power jams. They weren't really able to capitalize them. Queen City was, and that defense of Queen City was just stifling all game long.
Not just stifling, but really adaptive, which is, that's what won the game, was that adaptive defense and the ability to jump in and help whenever the jammer requested it. Now, it looks like we have an official review on the track.
You're watching
Queen City. So we're going to let umpire Strikes Back let us know what's going on.
Queen City review contesting one of the blocker points for the jammer being down when the blocker seated behind her. The jammer does not need to be standing to score that point in that scenario. The point stands. Loss of review.
Short, sweet, to the point. Thank you, umpire Strikes Back. So it will stand 195 to 104. We're not going to have any point adjustments here, but as we were saying, that really intense adaptive defense really won this for Queen City. They were quite quick to adjust to whatever that jammer needed. If they needed an offensive assist, they would let one go, but still stay really tight in that pack.
Yeah, and now Queen City, they've got a little bit of time to rest, but they're going to be back tomorrow. They're taking on arch rival for the opportunity to try and punch their ticket to go to Philadelphia.
Yeah. Absolutely. So we've seen some amazing derby here. And, you know, for Houston's first D1 appearance since 2014, I'll say this is a solid effort. And for having so many players on the team, that this is their first time to come to a division to a WFTDA playoff tournament, period. I think that's a solid performance that they should be proud of. So,
yeah, definitely. Great game by both teams. Thank you so much for tuning in. My name is Wilhelm Scream.
I'm Scarlett O'Hurtia.
You're watching WFTDA.tv.
Thank y'all. I'm Sissy Splasek here with Blackrock Bruiser.
Hi.
So that was amazing. That was such a fun game to watch. How are you feeling?
I feel great. That was, you know, we've been preparing for this all season, so, you know, we're ready.
Yeah. It was such good teamwork, and it really seemed like y'all were really on the same page and sort of even just playing like clockwork, like not stressing about it. So is that something y'all have practiced or?
Yeah, we've been really preparing this season, kind of working on our mental game. Just really trying to be positive with each other and, you know, working on communication, all that derby stuff. But we really try to just make sure that we have each other's backs.
So that's awesome. I also wanted to talk about, so you're on the newly formed Team Indigenous.
Yeah.
That's amazing. What does that feel like? What does it feel like to be on that?
It's unbelievable. It's one of the most just amazing experiences so far, just being able to meet other Indigenous women in the world and kind of connect and, you know, really get back to our roots and just learn about each other, learn about, you know, the things that we've went through and just grow from that. It feels amazing.
Yeah, I can't wait to see where that team goes. It seems like everyone's watching too. Yeah. It's really exciting. So y'all are going to go on to play arch rival at noon tomorrow. What are you going to do to prepare?
Oh man, I'm going to go and eat some snacks and just really chill out and hang out with my team and, you know, just really kind of get back into that mental game, get a really good night's sleep and wake up in the morning and just, you know, get back at it.
All right, well, congrats again, and good luck tomorrow. We're all rooting for you. Thanks.
Thank you.
You're watching WFTDA.tv.